Good day to you all. This is Double RPG here, and welcome to a brand new episode of the Riff Table Arcade with the Game Riffers. And joining me, we have my lovely co-hosts. We have 16-bit Jeff.
What's up, and what is this whole thing with a lovely?
Oh, come on. Just run with it. It's an ad-lib, dude. Run with it. Come on, be professional. All right. Anyway, and we also have FighterXaos.
Hello.
And we have our special guest returning back with us once again, our former 4DS podcast co-host, Dane, also known as Omega Mario 17. Welcome, man.
Thank you, Double R, and hello once again, everybody.
So, before we get started, how are we all doing today, or how have we all been doing this week?
Well, for me, I've been doing better compared to how this week started. Like, it started kind of rough because of what we're about to talk about for this week's episode, sadly. But it's been getting better personally for me.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat as you, too, dude. It's just with the recent news of what we're going to talk about, it really hit me hard, quite literally, and then I've been having trouble trying to stay focused with work, but I've been doing better for the most part.
Mm. That's funny. That's pretty much what I was going to say. Literally what I was just going to say. That's it. Doing better. I couldn't focus on my work either. And just today, before getting on Skype, was even when I got any actual work done, I was like, finally, I'm doing stuff again. Yeesh.
Any games that you guys have been playing as of recent?
J-Stars for me. Pick 3 versus Plus, that is, for PS4.
For that, because that's on Sony platforms, so you can't get it on Xbox.
Oh, yeah.
Curse you, Bandai Namco.
Well, it's because, yep. You know, Microsoft and something about Japanese relations, I don't know.
And, and here's another game you can't even get on Xbox consoles, and that's Godzilla the Game that just came out.
Oh, yeah, Gojira.
Which
definitely game I'm picking up.
Double R, you say, if you're a fan, is actually a good game.
Yes. It's a Godzilla fan's wet dream.
That's definitely great to hear.
I'll leave it at that.
Because some of the professional, quote-unquote, critics are saying that it's bad, but then all the fans who actually play the game are saying it's good.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of in the same situation as, Dragon Ball Xenoverse.
The Dragon Ball games, where Xenoverse it's a good example, yep.
Mm-hmm.
Where, like, critics are like, but the fans are like, this is amazing.
Yeah, but they're far more critical with Godzilla. I really know what they were thinking with that game. I mean, you literally play as Godzilla. I mean, Godzilla doesn't, he's not all that fast.
I was just going to bring that up. He's supposed to be slow. You ever seen him? You actually watch the Godzilla movie or what?
Yeah.
Exactly! I mean,
he's a big lumbering monster!
Mm-hmm.
Exactly!
He's Ric Flair, or I don't know.
Yeah, he's a force of destruction that's not meant to be reckoned with.
Hold on. He's not Ric Flair.
I don't know why that came to my head, but that's what came to my head.
Oh, man.
Okay, the only time I can think of a big destructive force in wrestling is Rikishi.
Or if we're going '70s, '80s, the Ultimate Warrior.
Yeah.
Or
not Ric Bloody Flair.
Or if we want to talk about in this day and age, Brock Lesnar.
Yeah, true.
Oh gosh, yes.
I could say, well, I don't know, his atomic breath, the womb, I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah. on my end? But on my end, on my 3DS, I've been playing a lot of Majora's Mask 3D due to the fact of, you know, the recent passing. It's, I don't know why, but I think just with the overall tone and theme of that game, I think it's still my favorite because of how comforting it is, why how very sweet the entire experience is with Majora's Mask, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's one of those games that aged really well.
Hmm. But on my Xbox One, due to the recent sale that they had, I got Tomb Raider Definitive Edition for $10. So I've been playing not only that, the digital version of it, but also the digital version of Sleeping Dogs Definitive Edition, because that's another game that I got from your digital sale a couple weeks ago. Very cheap. So yeah, I've been playing those two again, and I really enjoy both, and I cannot wait for this November to play Rise of the Tomb Raider. Too bad it's coming out the same day as Fallout 4.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong, I've gamed both games day one. Don't get me wrong, but I don't know how
you
it's...
think it's going to sell more, yeah.
Obviously Fallout 4.
One
but,
multi-platform.
But I think Tomb Raider is going to do good. I think it's going to do good, but...
It's
definitely going to do good.
Mm-hmm. Dane, how are you doing, man?
Not too bad. Had a bit of a crazy week, but getting over it.
Anything exciting you've been playing aside from playing World of Warcraft right now?
I've been dipping into like Team Fortress 2 and because of the new gun metal update, where they've added weapon skins in now, and like they've basically added in like a Counter-Strike global offensive thing in with like you get weapon skins for the guns.
Team Fortress 2, one of those games that literally has not finished completion on development yet.
Well, actually, it did finish development, but obviously because it being a PC game and digitally distributed by Steam, they can update it for, like, new stuff, so...
Yeah. I guess.
Like, nowadays on TF2, you can now pick up weapons of the same class. Like, if you're playing Scout and you're using the stock scatter gun and an enemy's got a Force of Nature, you kill them, you can then go and pick up their Force of Nature. So basically, you can just change your loadout on the fly if you want to. Just like a bit of a step up. Or if you're playing Heavy, then you can... and you're like just about to run out of ammo mid Uber charge, and someone else is playing Heavy. Kill that one, and then Nick is gone. While he still has more ammo than you. So.
Oh yeah.
It goes into that, and then obviously I've been playing World of Warcraft, not because of the movie that's got more and more information out about it in the upcoming trailer in BlizzCon in November.
With no Sam Raimi directing it, unfortunately.
Yeah, but Duncan Jones, who has a very good track record, so...
Well, yeah, I guess that's true.
So, I don't know. Like, I need to see more on the World of Warcraft movie, but... From what I've seen so far, it is something that, admittingly, might make me go, this is the video game movie I want to watch.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
And there was, like, this VR flyover from, I think it was San Diego Comic-Con or somewhere. That was, like, a flyover of the main city of Stormwind for the Alliance. And let me tell you, it looked so much like Skywind, I literally could not stop grinning.
Oh, man.
Well, you know what, Dane, with you grinning with the... I don't know. It's a good question.
That is a good question.
It's a very good question. But non-gaming related, with regards to grinning during San Diego Comic-Con, that was me with the announcements that DC Comics were making with their DC film slate, especially with the new trailer of Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice.
Finally shuts some people up, huh?
Some people up? How about majority of all the people that hated Batfleck?
Finally. Me and Jeff knew from the start that it wasn't going
to
be bad.
Yeah, although some people need to get their neck ringed because of them leaking the Suicide Squad trailer early.
But it looks good, though.
That's easy. WB just can send out Wonder Woman because she loves to snap necks. You know that, right?
Oh, yes.
I don't know about that Suicide Squad movie yet, or whatever it is. Is it a movie or TV show?
Whoa, it's a movie. It is a first look.
It's like about a month or two after, or it's like about a few months after Batman vs. Superman comes out.
Right. So, oh god, I didn't know exactly what way it would be, because...
Yeah, but people tend to forget the trailer...
But probably my favorite highlight from Comic-Con, in my opinion, was the first trailer of the Deadpool movie.
Oh god, yes.
Oh man, that had me just grinning all over the place, just how it was structured. Oh. But so yeah, that's another one of those movies I'm looking forward to next year, along with Batman vs. Superman and Suicide Squad. So definitely looks like that the time for where competition between both DC and Marvel at the movies, it's going to be starting next year in full force.
Well, not that, but you know what? I'm glad that I live in an era where I see that Marvel and now DC are being successful with their slates. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
I like DC more, but it's just like I like both more on DC since I was a kid, and I like to see that. I'm liking to see that both are being successful in this day and age. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
I can tell you this, like, when Phase 1 of the Marvel Universe, which was, like, the really old Spider-Man and the Fantastic Four, you know, the Tobey Maguire Spider-Man, the Andrew Garfield Spider-Man, I was like, these aren't really that great.
Mm-hmm.
Like, especially Spider-Man 3, like, that one's notoriously known for being a bit, I don't know what's the best way to put it,
tongue in cheek.
Sounded good on paper, but it was utter crap in
execution. It kind of aimed for the goalpost but went underneath. So like if you're looking at a American football goal, for example, like instead of it going over the actual line, it went underneath.
Yeah.
Hit the bottom post and then bounced off in the coach. But nowadays, like with the Andrew Garfield Spider-Man, like from Sony's end, and the X-Men Days of Future Past and First Class and all that, it's great to see the Marvel movies are actually stepped up now.
Mm-hmm.
So
very true. But anyway, we could talk about Comic-Con all we want, but we're probably going to save that for another episode coming next week.
Yeah,
I take it
on my channel. Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. So
yeah, we'll talk about it on then. Like, get me on then. We'll talk about more about comic movies and stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've been getting into a lot of them. So.
Absolutely. Anyway, let's get on with the recent events, our current events. So, as Jeff said, there was a recent passing that happened about 5 days ago. And for those of you who don't know or not that well aware of Nintendo, one of the people who I looked up highly ever since he started his tenure as president in 2002, Satoru Iwata, formerly of HAL Laboratories fame and former president and CEO, or global president and CEO of Nintendo, has sadly passed away at the age of 55 on Saturday, July 11th. So, yeah, it's just this news, it came out of nowhere with him just all of a sudden just passing away like that, because we knew that he had health complications as of recent because of last year where he had to have surgery to remove a tumor in his bile duct, and we thought that was what, you know, that was fully taken care of, but now it just came back and now taking his life away.
Yeah, it basically, like, we thought, oh, it was gone, he's safe, and stuff. And then all of a sudden, it just, like, went, did you miss me? And took him out, which...
Yeah,
it just,
and that's...
Like, I don't like the way I worded it just then, but that's the only way I can think of it. It was just,
Yeah, so it's just, like, all of a sudden, just this really bad bomb of bad news just dropped all over the internet and the world on that day. And for me, I was really distraught when I heard about this, because people who are well-respected or who are well-respected as individuals and really good leaders toward people, you usually would not expect them to die just, you know, just randomly like that. I mean, it's kind of like the same thing with school, like how some people, you know, where they always have a person where they are who kind of represents like the leader of like the whole class year or whatever, the graduating class year, but all of a sudden they just, something bad happens to their life where it just ends up taking their life. And I have seen this before, where a good friend of mine who was a really good leader for the class year just ended up just passing away because of a bad accident that happened. So yeah, it's just with Satoru Iwata's death, it just, this really was like playing a hand of deja vu from my eyes, because Satoru Iwata, he was a really well-respected figure within the industry and within the company as a whole, and then now you have this going around where not only does it hurt a lot of people, but it's hurting Nintendo as a whole right now too, and it's really hurting their morale in that sense. I mean, Jerry, what are your thoughts about Iwata's death? I mean, what was your first reaction when you heard about his death on that on the day after he died? When we officially learned the news, that is.
Oh, I'm about to say, because my very first reaction was it real? But it just... Oh, when we officially learned the news, I was shocked, because I thought... Well, first off, if you guys don't know about that bile duct growth, that's like a really, really rare form of cancer.
Mm-hmm.
Really rare. Often yeah. Fatal, but I thought he was okay, though. Like, I just thought, well, he's sick, but he'll pull through. And hearing that... It was a big shock because of that. Thinking that he was gonna be just, I thought he was be on the rebound. And B, because like, if you guys don't know, the average life expectancy in Japan is a lot higher than it is everywhere else in the world.
Oh, yeah. Definitely, yeah.
So his age was also a big shock. 55 is extremely young.
Very young for Japanese folks.
Especially for Japanese, yes.
Oh, especially for Japanese, but just any person
in general.
Is,
right? In general, yes, but especially for Japanese.
Even in their 50s, they're still, I would say, not. Well, I know a lot of people like to consider people who are in their 50s in the senior rate, but I still consider that to be a young age for people.
Yeah, I consider it young.
Very young.
And he's not the first, and he's not the only person that was under 60 to die this year. If you guys are wrestlers, a couple known wrestlers from the 80s died, and they were even younger. They were 53 and 54, and I'm like...
That's true.
What in the world's going on? People are dying too young.
Yeah.
Iwata, that was my first thought, was how shocking it was.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I even know this for a fact, too, is that, and I was talking to a good friend of mine about this today, about, you know, when it comes to cancer... It's not a thing that you can take lightly. I mean, even when somebody gets treated for cancer, and you know, when a doctor says that you're fine and it won't come back, don't even take that for granted, because there's going to be a point where, you know, it could potentially come back. And I think, I think that's something that we all need to take into account, because you know, that stuff. Even though they managed to isolate in some way, it doesn't mean that there's a chance that it won't come back. I mean, it could come back, very well come back, and just just hurt you big time in the end.
Yeah, no, not only that, but after when it happened, I was reading more about the type of cancer he had, which was the bile duct tumor that he had.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know if people realize that, but looking back, it had a high morality rate. So basically, the first round, I'll just say this, when it was first announced, I wouldn't be surprised if he was so worried about the state of his health that he was preparing for the future, not only for Nintendo but for him personally on his tenure as president, you know what I mean? Because I didn't know how high morality rate that bile duct, you know, growth had to begin with, you know what I mean?
Yep. Yeah, and it kind of makes me wonder if he actually knew that his health was still in very serious condition even after the operation last year, and we didn't even know about it.
Here's the thing. I think he knew, because you know how the format was for the digital event this year for Nintendo 3. They were using the Muppets.
Mm-hmm.
And I liked it before this announcement. I thought it was a cool way to, you know, to Nintendo to be their quirky yet expressive self at that event. But when you think about it, it's really, I don't want to sound rude, but it was really not bittersweet, but really. What's the proper term? I think you guys know what I'm trying to say, but
questionable, surreal.
It's surreal, yes, because when you thought about it, it's just like, wow, but it made a lot of sense. Like, it's really sad to think about it. His health wasn't rapidly deteriorating, mind you, because he was looking better even in June, which was the shocking thing. Like, the last we saw of him, which was in June, he looked very good for recovery. But just hearing it was just, that's right, you guys are right on dime right there. That was so sudden and so unexpected, even what he had. But like with Jerry, my feeling about the whole scenario when it happened, like when I found out ironically, like Jerry from you, Kyle, through Facebook, was that I thought it was some sick joke. Yeah. Like honestly, I really did.
Yeah.
But when I found out what's coming like from not only credible sources, but also from Nintendo Co. Limited over in Japan, the official word is just like, fuck.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, how many people have we lost over the last few years? I mean, it's been a lot, not only in gaming, but just overall.
Yeah, I mentioned two wrestlers under 50, and he was over 50, but Dusty Rhodes was, what, May or June he died?
Yeah.
June!
Yeah, last month. And it's just, it's really weird too, because last year was, oh my gosh, it was flooded. It was worse, yeah. Because a lot of great figures who we know from, not only from just people who are famous in from around the world, but like those who are in like the entertainment and movie and TV industry just ended up disappearing and fading away. Like Robin Williams, for example.
Oh god, that one hit me the hardest.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? It, like Robin Williams, this one hit me the hardest, the most too, because how much, not how talented the guy was, because he was very talented, don't get me wrong, as not only a CEO, but more importantly as a phenomenal programmer for Nintendo of his 30-year history with the company.
Mm-hmm.
It was how influential he was for not only his peers, but also for just basically his fans and gamers in this industry, and how much sincere he was as even a suit for a high-profile company like Nintendo, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, definitely. And I think we all should reflect back on what he said from GDC 2005. He says, and I do quote, "On my business card, I'm a corporate president. In my mind, I'm a game designer or a game developer. And in my heart, I am a gamer." That there has, I mean, speaks so much volume about the type of person that Satoru Iwata is, and that's still carried on to this day, even after he died.
Yeah, and you can even see in his influence of how it affected both, you know, both Sony and Microsoft's respected, you know, divisions regards to both Xbox and PlayStation, because look who's running those respective, you know, divisions now with Shuichi Yoshida and Phil Spencer. They are the people that have the same mindset as Iwata, and that, yes, they're suits, of course, but they're also gamers. They understand the material and the media, unlike the ones that were before them, especially Don Matrick, which I won't get into because I want to be respectful. But.
And I don't mean to be disrespectful, but Reggie Fils-Aimé, anybody?
We'll get into him
in another topic, but yeah.
I wanted to get into that about. Yeah.
That will be for a future episode, but yeah, like, well, that's why I like Iwata, because unlike Reggie, which no disrespect to him, because he has an impressive resume in different regions thanks to his portfolio. But for Iwata, I always respected him because, yeah, he was a suit, like I just said, but he it felt like he actually really cared about his consumer base in regards
his consumer base, the value of his employees. He was like a guy who was willing to sacrifice everything just to keep everything afloat. You know what I'm talking about?
And he did. And he did last year. I mean, when we heard the news that how bad the Wii U was, he actually took a pay cut. Okay, that's fine. But hearing that he took a pay cut of 50% of his own salary, no one, not even Phil Spencer or even Shoichi Yoshida, would do that.
Mm-hmm.
That shows how much committed the guy was and how distraught he felt about the console failing. And here's the thing. Yes, the 3DS has been doing better. But see, one console doing better while the other console is really floundering in sales, that shows how much committed the guy was in trying to turn things around. And I gotta give Iwata credit. He a lot of credit. He's been trying each trust even before his untimely death.
Mm-hmm. How much of a heart he had, you know?
Like, oh, yeah.
A lot of CEOs, you say, wouldn't do that because I don't care about people getting fired, whatever. He didn't want to see anybody get fired. He's like, they have families. He actually cared about his employees.
Mm-hmm.
No, like that, but it's also the fact, too, that, you know, unlike both Sony and Microsoft's division, with their respective manufacturers, they have the funds, they have the power, unlike Nintendo, which they do have a lot of money from the war chest they have acquired over the years from the Wii and 3 and DS, don't get me wrong, but not that much that they could do that. You know what I mean? I think they think better in regards to the planning of a company's future than, say, Sony and Microsoft, where they do think about that, but they think more about the here and now. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, did Dane say anything?
I think he said a little bit, but Dane, what do you think?
Yeah?
I mean,
it's all right. I had to go and grab my phone, but carry on.
That's all right. I mean, what do you think about Iwata with the type of mindset he has, you know, when he was global president, to where not only did he think like a game designer, but in his heart he was a gamer, but he would sacrifice a lot of things in order to keep things afloat, to where he would make sure that Nintendo would, you know, push forward it without, you know, losing morale in the end because of the struggles that they've had for the last few years.
Honestly, I think, like, when I heard that he did that, I had, like, massive respect for him, because, like you guys said, you don't really hear many CEOs do that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you don't hear them just be like, oh, we'll give up some of our jet. And the fact that I did that, I had, like, really big respect, because that's all I can say. Like, it did shock me, but any of the other achievements he's done, he's done like so much for Nintendo.
Mm-hmm.
A lot, like, and there was this show that I keep seeing on, like, Game Explain, the tribute videos from them, and then Eurogamer. There was one where he was, like, showing off Balloon Fight. Someone was there, was like, this is a really good game, and he was like, thank you very much. Like, and how he said it.
Game CX, Game Center CX, yeah. Right?
Uh-huh. And, you know, speaking of Balloon Fight, some even made a hack to include a sprite of Satoru Iwata in the game as the main character with the balloons or whatever, and I thought that was actually pretty cool of a tribute to him.
No, yeah. That the current tribute that's going on through change.org for that petition to make the Balloon Fight character a future Smash fighter,
mm-hmm,
in honor of Iwata, I think it's a good idea. And also, I don't know about you guys, but how would you feel about a Iwata amiibo? Like, would you think Nintendo would do that, or would you think it would be too tacky for them? You know what I mean, would you think that would be too distasteful for Iwata's members?
I wouldn't say an amiibo would be a good idea, because of all these scalpers.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Like, honestly, like, if the minute there was, like, an Iwata amiibo, like, people would just buy it and chuck it on eBay for, like, four-digit numbers, and that would be really disrespectful.
But honestly,
I don't think that's a good idea.
Maybe if they did something like, you know, with the whole partnership that Nintendo's doing with Universal, that they make a monument in Iwata's honor.
Oh,
I've
yeah.
I've actually seen that suggested.
You know, that's actually realistic. That is a lot realistic to happen, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Something like that's a more better idea than...
Yeah, because I've been thinking about it. It's just, it's like, remember last year when the sad... sad passing of Robin Williams just died. When people were making a petition for him to be part of the upcoming Legend of Zelda game, and people have been doing the same thing if we wanted. And I feel like the more I see those two being influential in different parts, but they were influential from Nintendo, I was like, you know what? I think those two, especially Iwata, should be like, you know, NPCs in that game in their honor. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, the more I think about it, you know what I mean?
Like, oh, yeah.
Because...
Like, in Zelda Wii U, sorry to cut you off, Jeff. In Zelda Wii U, they should have a room like in Wind Waker with, I can't remember what it's called. I know it's Nintendo something. In Wind Waker.
Mm-hmm.
There's like this special room you can get access to via, I think it's like a Game Genie, or it is actually in the proper game. I can't remember now. Like, where it's had like models and that of, and lore of Zelda.
Mm-hmm.
I think. Like, something like that in Zelda Wii U with, like, tributes to Robin Williams and Satoru Iwata will be just brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Personally, I reckon they should do.
Oh, definitely. But, yeah, it's just... I would definitely think that the balloon fight character being a playable character in Smash Brothers for Wii U and 3DS as upcoming DLC for free could actually be the most realistic thing to happen. But as far as the others, I can't really see it being possible, but for like NPC characters of Iwata and Robin Williams in the new Zelda game for Wii U, I could definitely see that being a possibility if Nintendo were to actually commit to that idea.
Mm-hmm.
Before we talk about what we believe what Iwata's best and worst accomplishments were for the company Nintendo, whether he was a game developer or president for the company, let's talk about a couple of topics in relation to Iwata before we get to that final hearsay within the within this episode. The first we're going to talk about is about some things you didn't even know about Iwata, and honestly, I didn't really know that much about Iwata and these types of things that he did as a game developer and as a president for Nintendo during his time when he was in the gaming industry starting in the 80s up until he passed on. And we did talk a little bit about like why he valued employees very highly and how he took a pay cut in order to try to things along to make sure that Nintendo would stay afloat with its morale and as a business instead of just taking losses for granted and that kind of stuff. I think everybody can agree based on what Iwata has said based on when somebody asked him during the 73rd annual shareholders meeting, which I think it was 2 years ago. Yeah, they asked why the company hadn't restructured on account for the operating losses. And this is what he said. He said, if we reduce the number of employees for better short-term financial results, however, employee morale will decrease, and I seriously doubt employees who feared that they may be laid off will be able to develop software titles that could impress people around the world. I also know that some employers publicize their restructuring plan to improve their financial performance by letting a number of their employees go, but at Nintendo, employees make valuable contributions in their respective fields, so I believe that laying a group of employees will not help to strengthen Nintendo's business in the long run. So, yeah, I mean, I definitely agree to that. I mean, of course, we're living in really tough times right now financially because how the world economy has been. But, you know, you got to take into account that even though some businesses, they go through really tough times, sometimes, you know, a company president has to, you know, be a part of that and make sure that nothing goes wrong for them and everything can, you know, still keep going on well, even if things look very bleak for them. You know what I mean?
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
I definitely think this was a really good spot on answer from you know, that was coming from him, whether people agreed with him or not. But honestly...
Oh, great.
Yeah, but honestly, it kind of makes me wonder if they'll actually carry that same tradition now that he's gone whenever they announce his successor in the future.
See, that is the thing I'm worried about, and not to be distasteful about the guy's passing, but that is one thing I'm worried about, because for a successor for Iwata, for NCL, I'm hoping that they... I hope they find someone that has the business etiquette of what to do right and what to not to do, but at the same time to have the proper philosophy that both Yamauchi and late Satoru Iwata it's still hard to get used to that, but that those two shared the same philosophies. I want to see the successor also the same mindset of an actual businessman to make sense. Make actual business, you know, decisions, and not to make the wrong ones. You know what I'm saying? You need to have someone to have both of those play fields, you know what I mean?
Yeah, and I think that person needs to also have the same mindset where you have to value employees highly based on that philosophy that Iwata went by if they want to keep that image of them delivering great software to everybody.
And not only that, but it's not only while I was passing, but this coming generation of the NX is going to be a very interesting generation for Nintendo as a whole, because I see a lot of people either leaving or retiring from the company.
Really?
Mm.
Like Shigeru Moto, he's getting up
there. Oh yeah.
Gendo Takata, and I'm bringing those two specific up because at the time they're temporary. They're sharing temporary
representative directors.
Yeah.
Representative
since the passing of Iwata, and I don't think either one is going to take the position. Like, I will be fine with Miyamoto, but here's the thing. With his itch, I would rather have him as CEO over here in America, personally. Either him or Bill Trenton, but when it comes to people leaving, I could see Shigeru Miyamoto finally making his retirement during the NX development generation, as well as Gendo Takata, which is something big too, because he has been one of the big, you know, influencers for the hardware mainstream side for the last couple of generations for Nintendo. But there's one particular person I think will be leaving, and that would be Reggie Fils-Aimé. I think he is going to be leaving during this upcoming generation due to the fact that, you know, I just don't feel like he fits for the company anymore. Like his ideal as a CEO, specifically for America, I just don't see him fitting with Nintendo's, you know, whole philosophy, you know what I mean? But that's the thing that's really going to be interesting yet terrifying at the same time. You know, I'm not trying to be distasteful, but, you know, with Iwata's passing, it's just so sudden. It's just, you know, this... If you want to know why people are so terrified, this has never happened in Nintendo's history.
No.
At all. Ever. Because here's the thing, that Iwata was the fourth president, right? Because the last three were of the Yamauchi lineage.
Yeah, the first president not to be that of the Yamauchi bloodline to run the company. Yep.
And his... And it was just like 13 years ago when he became president.
That's
compared
not...
to how... long Yamauchi president and overseer of Nintendo?
That's not a line.
That's short. Mm-hmm. Very short.
Yeah.
And, you know, my big problem with his passing is just how disrespectful this YouTube community has become, and I'll get to that at the end, but I'm just bringing that up.
God, I don't want to even think about it, but...
I'm going to bring it up, because...
Yeah, I hear you. But anyway, let's move on to the next part that you may not have known about Iwata, and he was... an exceptional primer who saved Earthbound. At the time, Earthbound was known as Mother 2 in Japan, and by the time when it was being developed, Iwata was working as a programmer in the head of HAL Laboratories, which was one of the development teams behind Earthbound at the time. And when he saw the difficulties that the development team, along with Shigisato Itoi, were having with Mother 2, he voiced his doubts that the game could be completed on time. And he said this, "If we used what you have now and fix it, it'll take 2 years. But if we can start fresh, it'll take half a year." And Iwata then took over development of Mother 2 and returned a month later, having got the game's map-scrolling feature to work. and once he joined the team, the game only took another year of development thanks to Iwata's programming match. So, yeah, looks like Mother 2 or Earthbound managed to come out at a really good time instead of being late into the SNES and Super Famicom's life cycle.
Not only that, but speaking of Mother 2, I do like the fact that during a power outage during its development is that he salvaged a lot from being lost from that power outage that happened during the development of Mother 2.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. I think it was you or someone said that he literally, I can't remember exactly what you said he did, like, if you want to reiterate what he did.
Like, map scrolling, and I think that was at least one of the things, but...
And also the difficulty of the enemies, too, I think.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, the guy, even though he has some structure within him, he had a lot of game development structure within his blood to where he could actually, you know, bring about his magic to save a game. And, you know, Earthbound being a prime example of that. And loader number 3, and I know Jerry's going to be excited about this one. When Game Freak made Pokemon Gold and Silver, only the Johto region was included in the game. Iwata thought that players deserved more, so he spent some of his spare time squeezing the entire country of Kanto, the region from the first generation of Pokemon, which was Blue, Red, Green, and Yellow, using some very heavy compression. He essentially fit in a whole extra game like it was no big deal.
Mm-hmm. And I'll love him forever for it.
Mm-hmm.
Pokemon Gold and Silver was great. Like,
no,
back in that era, like back not only in that era, like the fact of it just bringing like new like systems to the Pokemon games with clocks and everything. It's just also the fact that Kanto was exactly Kanto. When someone said to me, did you know that, like, when I found out, I mean, not when someone told me, but when I found out that Iwata did that, I was like, holy moly.
Mm-hmm. No, that's
the fact reason, it was just that's my favorite
a perfect
generation.
Answer.
Yeah. But if I recall, too, because people don't know, the original versions of Pokemon Red and Green before the U.S. Release back in 90, it was 95 or 96, right? Around that time frame.
Well, the Japanese.
But those two releases,
Yeah, Gold and Silver didn't come out until like 1992, something like that.
Yeah. But with specifically Red and Green, I think if I recall, he had development. He had a background with those two because if I recall correctly, both Red and Green, the original versions, were just. I don't get how they were. I don't get how they were successful because those games were jank. These original were mess. Were a big mess.
Yeah, they were jank as crap, man. They had especially the just go back and look up Red and Green original. The graphics were weird. The music, the Lavender Town music was so janky that it would cause.
Create its own creepypasta.
Yeah.
Well,
basically.
The actual if science. I know the creepypasta is that kids kill themselves, but the actual science is that it did cause headaches, though, because the frequencies were too loud.
Yeah, it did. Oh, yeah, but if I recall correctly, if you can clarify, Kyle, Iwata did have involvement of fine tuning Red and Green, the original Japanese version, with the special blue version
blue,
in Japan,
which
right?
Which is what our Red and Blue is.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, yeah, because people don't realize that the Red and Green original versions of Pokemon, we were just discussing how horrible they were. That's the reason why I'm still shocked at how popular Pokemon has become over the last almost 20 years. Because those shouldn't have been sisters, you know what I mean? But yet they were in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
But that is one story I like from Iwata's lineage as a programmer because it shows how right there with when he would become a CEO that he actually did care about the consumer, you know what I mean? Because if he didn't, he's just like, yeah, just push it out. Doesn't matter.
Okay.
Now,
all right.
I don't want to rush, but we'll go ahead, double R.
Speaking of Pokemon, we also got to make a mention, and this is going to number four, that Iwata ported over the Pokemon battle logic without reference documents when it came to Pokemon Stadium on the Nintendo 64. And that was a really big deal at the time.
Yeah, it was.
Basically, he just learned the battle battle logic without, like I said, without reference doc, meaning he just learned it by just looking at the code and just going and just figured it out himself.
And he did it within a week. He did it within a week.
I know.
Just shows you how skilled he is as a game designer. And going into number five, Iwata announced Super Smash Bros. Brawl before telling the development team.
Oh, that's my favorite one. That is my favorite one.
I hate to be distasteful, but I bet it's like, we are making a new Smash Brothers, and it is going to be Super Smash Brothers Brawl. Wait, what? Since when?
And then he goes over to Hal. We are going to make a new Smash Brothers, and I already announced it. And then Hal's like, sure.
Wait,
why not? No, luckily Hal agreed to make it. That's
No, I know, I know, but I bet they were thinking in their eyes like,
exactly.
What the hell?
Exactly.
Yeah, no.
This next one's interesting that it was his idea.
Number six, the Miiverse integration in Super Mario 3D World was his idea. I mean, in what it says in the passage, it says, Nintendo's often been criticized for being slow to adopt online gaming, but the integration of the Miiverse in Super Mario 3D World truly let you feel like you are part of a bigger community. The game's map would be populated by the Miis of players around the world, whose messages would pop up as you pass them, a small but effective feature. And I agree to that. I know a lot of people still wait for the Super Mario games, especially like the new Super Mario Brothers games, to have online multiplayer. But for a thing like Miiverse integration having that kind of effect, I say, you know, if an alternative like that exists, then, and if it works, then hey, I'm down with that.
Honestly, I was thinking about this before Iwata's passing. I think, you know, the Mario franchise will have online play with the NX
eventually. Yes,
I think NX will be the system that will have online compatibility with the Mario series, because people tend to forget that does have to have a big part of the specifications inside of the Wii U.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's a reason why I didn't have, you know, online play or all these, you know, premium services we're accustomed to, because of how the specs in the Wii U was optimized to begin with, custom for Nintendo. But that is one feature, not just in 3D World, but just the entire of the Wii U architecture that I love and got into since day one when I got my console back in 2012.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, Miiverse integration has been implemented with other games on the Wii U and 3DS, like Hyrule Warriors, Bayonetta 2, even Smash Brothers, and, you know, some other games, too, and even, like, the recent Art Academy Home Studio, where you can draw pictures, or you can paint pictures, color them, draw them, and whatever. And also, I need to make a small disclaimer, just a side note based on that. As of recent, I picked up Art Academy Home Studio, and I did post a speed drawing of me drawing a strawberry on my YouTube channel, and it was featured on Nintendo Enthusiast's own review Art Academy Home Studio on their YouTube page. Pardon me.
Nice.
That's like a Nintendo Capri Sun joke right there.
Yeah, pretty much.
Art Academy Home Studio, though, they did their review, and that speed drawing I did of the strawberry was briefly shown during view, which amongst the many other speed drawings that are on YouTube based on that program were in the review. So I feel quite honored with that, you know, for them having that. But anyway, just thought I'd throw that in there, and I'll put a link in the description. Yeah, and I'll put a link in the description so you can go look at both the speed drawing as well as the review, because I thought the review was pretty good. But anyway, back to where we were. Number seven, interesting tidbit about Iwata is that he actually went out and bought Ocarina of Time when it launched.
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time was launched in November 1998 when Iwata was finishing up Super Smash Bros. For the Nintendo 64. And this is what he said when the game came out. I was at the Nintendo Kyoto headquarters for a meeting to prepare for its launch, and I bought Ocarina of Time on my way home. That's interesting. Mm. I mean, for him to do something like that when he was working on another game, and I'm pretty sure he didn't even know about what was going on with the development structure of Ocarina of Time, you know, during that time period.
I know.
So he must have, you know, I guess he went into the game, or I guess he bought the game with just a clear mind, not knowing what to expect or whatever. And I know.
Yeah, because I think he was wanted to have a perspective of the consumer base regards to that title because of how many revisions that game had, because there was a lot that went through the development of Zelda Ocarina of Time.
Oh, yeah. And I know a lot of people like to debate whether or not if it's the best Zelda or if it's overrated, but you gotta look at the eyes from Iwata, you know, from Iwata when he picked up the game, you know, with that mentality of what he was, how he was looking at it. So, yeah. I mean, so let's just view it in the eyes for how he viewed it, and maybe you'll see it for what it, then you can be the judge from there. So,
yeah.
And you know, I think that's a lot, and I think that's something that a lot of people should have in this day and age. Instead of being overhyped so much, they should just look at the eyes with not knowing that much about a game and just view it for what it is and then judge for what it is. Because I think that can actually save a lot of, you know, that could actually have a different opinion about what they actually think of the game rather than just going by, you know, previews and hype and such. Because I know there's factors where you have to hype a game and preview it to determine whether or not a consumer wants to actually purchase it. But, you know, going in just without word of mouth, it sometimes can actually be either a surprise or just a big letdown in the end. You know what I mean?
The thing is, though, with today's generation of, like, all these gaming websites and YouTube and that, it's like we've got to know about a game before it comes out, like a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So it just I don't know.
Well, but anyway, so number eight, his first published game was Super Billiards, and that was actually a game that was put out by HAL for the MSX home computers in Japan. So it was basically a game of billiards in MSX style, basically. So Iwata coded his first commercial game during the time of his college education in Tokyo. And like I said, it was published by HAL and launched on the MSX home computer. So that was not the first game he ever created. Balloon Fight was not the first game that he created, even though it was the first game he worked on for Nintendo. But his first published game that he created was Super Billiards.
Yep. Well, yeah, that first commercial game was that, but the very first game he created himself was just on a freaking normal calculator, and it was a baseball game. That blew my mind when I found it out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because I could never figure out how to work those super calculators that can do those things.
Boy, he was a prodigy back then.
Yeah, no kidding.
Hmm. Okay, number nine, Iwata updated his Mii character to reflect his illness. And we all know the story about Iwata's health problems as of recent, then they were well documented. But, yeah. And you know, much like Steve Jobs, Iwata lost a lot of weight up to his death. But his updated Mii avatar to reflect this, along with the message that came below the Miiverse, or to hit the Miiverse post, you know, with this Mii. It says, because of the operation I underwent in June last year, I've become a little thin. My weight has more or less remained the same since I left the hospital. It seems as though I'll be able to maintain this figure. So I decided to update my official me to reflect my present condition. Please be kind to it. And, you know, looking at the me, it definitely does give an accurate representation of what he looked like after he lost all that weight when we first saw him, like, for the first time. I think it was, like, November in 2014 when he had that Nintendo Direct by then?
Was it November? Because I thought it was either January or February the first time we saw him come back, to be honest.
I think it was November, because it was like right after 5 months, and I know there was a Nintendo Direct by then, and we actually got to see Iwata for the first time since then.
Yeah, I know that, but I'm just trying to recall what it was. But yeah, during that time when he came back, you could tell how much weight he lost due to the overall trauma that the surgery was, basically.
Mm-hmm. And number 10, even though this is based on pure just speculation just from the writer, but the NX, which we still don't know that much about, is likely going to be an embodiment of Iwata's ideals going forward after, succeeding the Wii U as a dedicated home video game platform. But again, we still don't know that much about the NX until we know more in next year, whoever presents the information. But we'll just have to wait and see what they've decided. I mean, I really hope that a lot of the ideas that people hope for are taken into consideration, but you never know. Something may actually come and surprise us that we may not even know about.
See, that's the thing with Nintendo consoles. It's just like, with the Wii U, yes, it was I think we can all agree respectfully that it was a bomb for Nintendo, right? Like, sales-wise.
Sales-wise, yes.
In sales and in marketing, it was a complete failure. But that said, like, when I get a Nintendo console, I do want it to have that Nintendo feeling. You know what I mean? Like, you can tell it's a dedicated home platform, but it's a Nintendo dedicated platform. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't mind the gimmick, but at the same time, I do. Like, like I've said before, and I'll say it again, in a sense, like, how people will want to see a console be more focused on gaming rather than social media and overall media for, like, you know, and that type of stuff. That's how I feel with Nintendo's gimmicks. I like it being there, but I don't want to be a forced option. I'd rather have it be a, you know, an actual option, like, for control. Uh-huh. I don't mind the gimmicks. Like, that's the thing. I like the gamepad, but it's just how it's tethered worth of the system. I feel it's one, I don't want to say big flaw, but it was a flaw in the design of the Wii U. You know I mean?
Yeah.
That said, I love the Wii U, even though I had contemplation of selling my unit, not because of how poorly been, like most people have, because let's face facts, there's two things I will call gamers, the entire gaming community, are fickle and hypocritical.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the fact that, you know, they're having a new console come out next year. You know what I mean? While we don't know what it is, it's still a new console. That's the reason why I've been complaining about it. It's not the fact of how poorly it's done. And to be fair, it's one of Nintendo's most ambitious platforms they've done in a long time, not because of the gamepad, but just because of how diverse for Nintendo the lineup has been in regards to software library.
Mm-hmm.
But continue what you were going to say, Kyle. Sorry about that.
Anyway, those are 10 things that you might not even know about Iwata, and a lot of them I was actually very surprised by, based on what I brought up to you all, especially with the Earthbound and both Pokemon Gold and Silver, how we managed to make those games become what they were.
It's funny you brought the thing up for Brawl, because the only one I knew about Smash Bros. Related was how he really did mad programming on Shape Up Melee for its release. That's the only one I knew.
Mm-hmm.
Same man.
Oh yeah, and it's still a lot of people's most favorite to this day because of its competitive nature. You know, being the most competitive out of all of them.
To be fair, I think the most competitive was the recent one for me, at least.
For me too. I agree with you where you're coming from, Jeff.
But GameCube is still a good title. The GameCube one was still a good title, but I feel like the recent two were having a better competitive title. But continue.
Anyway, now since Iwata has passed on, there are 5 games that you all can play to honor the late Nintendo president. And what you don't have to do it now, but, you know, if you ever plan on doing any live streams or any Let's Plays or any review or anything to honor the guy, there's 5 that you can play right here and now. And those 5 are, and ones that we pretty much mentioned, they're Balloon Fight, Earthbound, Super Smash Bros. Melee, Pokemon Stadium, and Pokemon Gold and Silver. And, you know, there may be a point in my time with working videos and stuff, where I may get around to probably doing a live stream or something, probably either Earthbound or something, to where I can actually, on guy. So, if we ever got around to, doing something for fun, where I get back to the whole live streaming bid, which I haven't done so in quite a while, but if I ever get back to it, then maybe we could pop in Earthbound and just, have a hell of a fun time. I mean,
pretty sure we know some people are good at the game, because I don't have a clue.
I mean,
sadly, it's like one of the games that I need to learn to get a hold of, because I want to try it.
When Iwata passed away, did any of you guys play any of those games after he passed on, just to honor him?
Yeah, I played a little bit of Earthbound on my, not my Wii U, but just because, it was just available to me, my laptop.
Uh-huh.
By using I actually got my Wii U Pro controller to work on my laptop, which was cool, so yeah, I was using that to play Earthbound, and yeah, it just felt so real to play that game after his passing, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I played a little bit of Balloon Fight, ironically, too.
Oh, I know. I had no idea about Balloon Fight being his first game that he worked for when working with Nintendo as the main programmer for it. When we heard the announcement of Virtual Console games finally coming to the Wii U in 2013, and with Balloon Fight being the very first one, and I remember Iwata saying, Balloon Fight was the very first game that I worked on during my time at Nintendo.
Hmm.
That really caught me off guard. Really surprised me. And, the game itself, even though it's mostly points-based, it still has a really good sentiment of replay value, as much as old games like Donkey Kong and even Battletoads for that, in that sense.
I think what makes Balloon Fight, viable is because of the score-based nature and especially the survival thing we saw in the Nintendo World Championships.
Uh-huh.
Like, the fact that Balloon Trip on there is, the most addictive for, score-based stuff. Mm-hmm. I think people still, go back to it on, their 3DS Ambassador versions and...
Yes.
And all even... that to try and get the...
And that even became, that even became, a huge focus in NES Remix, if I'm not mistaken.
I've not really... because I don't own a Wii U, or I've got my cousin's old 3DS here, but I can't find a firm charger for it, so
yeah,
I can't get the NES Remix game on there, so
oh,
I haven't really tried it.
Okay,
I want to.
Well, anyway, and with the game refers, we know that Jerry still had Pokemon Gold and Silver Let's Play that he does.
Yep. We have the footage, just like with Thousand Arms. We have the footage, we just need to rip it.
Mm. And we've done our share of honors toward Iwata, too, in some capacity, even when the guy was still alive. But, if any of you guys have any of those five games we mentioned, then play them to your heart out. They're definitely pretty good for what they are, and what they did for Nintendo as a whole, based on Iwata's contributions and all that.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. So yeah, you guys definitely have our blessing with that. And last but not least, we finally made it to the end of the episode, where we each talk about what we felt was Iwata's best and worst accomplishments. And I think we should restrict this for each with delivering one best and one worst accomplishment. Yeah. So, who wants to go first? Should I go first? Or some should go first with the best?
Should Double R go first or last? Mr. Nintendo.
I think he should go first.
Alright.
Okay. Probably the best accomplishment that Iwata has done with his time at Nintendo, whether he was, still a game developer or president, was how much of a contribution he had to breaking the barriers between gamers and non-gamers, especially when it came to both the Wii and the DS, with how they managed to become massive successes for the company. It's like, we know the story about the Wii, how it's mostly eccentric towards casuals, but while there were still some games that even core gamers could still they'll get into and Nintendo fans could get into. But it's just the concept itself. It's just like, it definitely deserved the name Revolution at the time when it was still in its code name. And I was really surprised with the delivery of what it all achieved during its life cycle, even though Nintendo had kind of started to back away from it by the time they started to go into the Wii U. But, you know, for its time, it was pretty phenomenal. And even with the DS, with a lot of the games that both core gamers and RPG nuts and casuals can even get into. Like, for casuals, there was always the Brain Age games, and even for the core gamers, there was always the JRPGs that were on there. And that was like the guy like just literally took a risk with breaking away tradition, which, you know, we've always made our presence and letting Nintendo know that they need to compete. But, you know, sometimes when somebody breaks away, you know, it can be a crapshoot whether or not if it'll actually be a hit or miss. And I know a lot of people like to disregard both the Wii and the DS as happy accidents or whatever, but I highly disagree, because I honestly thought they were really good for what they were and what they tried to commercially and critically, you know, for the company going forward. But at the same time, there were some things that had some negative impacts, especially when it came to the Wii U. But, you know, you gotta remember about what the Wii originally tried to do, instead of just, you know, going by the same shtick of being just a regular home console, you know, just even for one time only. But you know, it did what it did, and history is that. And I know a lot of people don't like to consider the Wii as a success, but you gotta remember, sales do matter, and that was the console sales leader, and both the handheld sales leader in the last generation of gaming, whether you like
it or not. Oh, definitely.
Yeah, so I definitely thought that was Iwata's best accomplishment he did during his tenure as president, was that how he managed to bring both gamers and non-gamers together to play a Nintendo console or a Nintendo handheld in that stature.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's my take on Iwata's best. Who's next?
I'll go.
Okay.
And you know what, in regards, it's a funny thing, because with the greatest accomplishment he had, I agree with you. It's like, okay, the Wii and DS weren't my favorite platforms from Nintendo, but I still respect what they accomplished and what they did going forward after, you know, Iwata succeeded Yamauchi as CEO and president of Nintendo Co. Limited.
Mm-hmm.
Because people don't remember, while the GameCube was the strongest, you know, console on the market next to the PS2 and Xbox, the original Xbox, it was still doing poorly.
Mm-hmm.
So they had to choose an option. It was like, okay, do we stay the core, do something drastically different? And I'm glad they did something drastically different instead of having a similar system that was just like the other two competitors. Mm-hmm. And say well about the Wii and the DS, if it wasn't for those two, you know, those two consoles did one thing, and I said this last night too on Facebook, that I feel like that it was the last time we saw it was when the launch of the original PlayStation happened in the mid-90s, and I think even Nintendo, comparing with the sales of the PlayStation 1, were even more successful. That was bringing, you know, making the industry and most of all gaming more inclusive, and that instead of seclusive like how it's been, because of both how the competitors have been competing with one another out of the last couple of generations, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Mm.
Like, don't get me wrong, I like all three, but that's because I'm a gamer. I'm not a fan to either side. Like, yeah, I like Microsoft and Nintendo more than I do Sony, but I like all three, and I play all three platforms because mm-hmm. I'm a gamer at the end of the day. I would like to own all three if I had the option to, but if I own only two, then I wouldn't mind, because I still get majority of the good games that come out for all three consoles if I had the option to. But Nintendo, I applaud that they did that, you know what I mean?
Exactly. And I've also said this before too, even if you can't own all of them, then at least acknowledge and respect the competition, please. You don't don't need to be a brass fanboy and defending your own console and showing disrespect to the other, because that really just paints an image of how bad or just how poor you are as a gamer. You know what I mean? Anyway,
I'm not starting a babble of everyone going to say the specific podcast here on YouTube. I'm not going to say anything, but you know by just by their attitude.
Yeah.
But what you were saying, Jerry?
Hello?
Yeah.
So, what do you believe Iwata's best accomplishment was during his time at Nintendo, whether if he was game developer or president?
That's easy.
Pokemon?
Yeah. Gold and silver, I mean, adding Kanto to that. That's the whole reason Generation 2 was my favorite, because you could go back to Kanto. You had twice the game. You know, no other. I still haven't seen that any other. No other Pokemon game made me feel as happy as Gold and Silver made me feel.
No, that, but you haven't seen anything like that from Xbox or PlayStation doing that either.
That's true. I was about to bring that up. Like, I don't think of it. Games on the other consoles also have you go back to the previous game and say, hey, remember all that cool stuff you did in part one? Just do it again, alright?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, now you're the super bounce.
You know, that I think they kind of actually did that to what Camelot did with Golden Sun when it came to Lost Age. There was like a glitch where you could actually go back to the first starting continents of the original Golden Sun, but the only downside is that you couldn't even visit the towns that were actually in that game.
Still interesting glitch.
Heck, not even the Elder Scrolls has you like in Skyrim go, hey, you want to go back to Cyrodiil? Well, too bad, you can't. Like, oh.
Yeah. Or even the original Legend of Zelda. Or, I mean, when going into Zelda 2 Adventure Link. You want to go back to the original Legend of Zelda's place? Since both games are connected? Sorry, you can't even do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and for some reason, Skyrim is still considered best game of the year 2010 all days, every day, right?
I mean,
the game came out.
Yeah, 2011.
I don't get people. Oblivion stinks. Oblivion, like, come on.
Come on.
Oblivion's good.
But yeah. Daggers Fall, every day, son. Every day.
If you can get it to work.
Omega, what do you believe Iwata's best accomplishment was as either game developer or president for Nintendo?
I'd have to go with the obvious that it was Balloon Fight. Like, that game is addictive as all hell.
Mm-hmm.
Like, when I got it as part of the 3DS Ambassador Program, I think it was part of that.
Yeah.
Or wasn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
Well, whichever way I played it, I just couldn't stop playing it. Like, it was just one of them games that you just think, oh, I'll just play for 10 minutes and you'll play it for an hour. Like, that game was just amazing. And then the Pokemon Stadium was just a bomb as well.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact of the matter is that he managed to get the battle system just right for a 3D Pokemon game. Hats off to him, honestly. Mm-hmm. It's like, that battle system is just as good as the 2D ones. And
yeah.
I applaud him for that, because his work in Stadium influenced Colosseum and XD. And Battle Revolution.
Mm-hmm.
It now just makes me wish they actually made another 3D Pokemon Stadium-like game.
I know.
But then again, you've got a 3D Pokemon game now, in a sense, with the 3DS era of Pokemon games. So.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah.
Kind of makes me wonder how Pokemon Tournament's actually going to do well as a Pokemon game when it comes out.
Hmm.
Yeah, but the funny thing about that is, it's not like any, you know, it's not your usual Pokemon Coliseum based fighter. It's an actual fighter, like,
it's a
Tekken fighter. So yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yes.
Even though Harada comments that it's not in the same vein as Tekken, but you gotta admit that with a name like Pokken sounding similar to Tekken, yeah, there's bound to be some similarities between Tekken, I mean, of Tekken being in this new game. To some degree. But anyway, now it's time to move on to Iwata's worst accomplishment. Should we go in the same order again, or should we go first this time?
I want to go first. Let me go first.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Jared first.
Plus, I gotta eat dinner.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is simple. I don't know. I don't think he came up with the name. But green lighting the name Wii U, allowing it? Come on.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's not confusing at all. Says the person who, when you still talk to people, they still think it's a frickin' add-on to the original Wii.
Mm-hmm.
To this day, people still think it's an add-on.
Yeah.
So, I don't know why he allowed it to go. He couldn't just stop somebody and say, wait a minute. Can we think at least Wii 2 or something?
Or a Super Wii.
Or Wii 8.
Yeah.
Or Super Wii. Not just Wii U. Or it sounds like an add-on, too. I mean, shoot. Sounds like a U thing you add to your Wii. That's all I got.
Sounds like a fire truck.
It's just allowing that.
Or an ambulance.
Because again, I don't think he came up with the name, but allowing the name to stay.
Yeah.
He could have vetoed it, couldn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
Definitely, yes, he could.
Okay.
Get all the wee-wee jokes out of our system.
The wee-wee joke. Okay, who's next?
I'll go next. And it's similar to what Jerry said, but it's... I would say it was the name of the original name marketing for Wii. Like, I got it, but... Like what Dane just stated, everyone remembers E3 2006 when it was originally announced and all those Wii jokes are made. Yeah. Like, I love the system for what it is, but I still don't get why to this day they went with that finalized name instead of the Nintendo Revolution, because I feel like that would have been a better console name for the console instead of Wii. It's like, it's not like a failure in my eyes, it's just as more as like, Why should you do that? You know what I mean? Like,
mm-hmm.
If I have to choose, I would go with Jerry, what he said about the Wii U, because, yeah, the Wii was stupid in the sense of with all the jokes that were made even way back before the console was launched.
Uh-huh.
But the Wii U is just like, yeah, if there's one thing you do not screw up, it's in both the marketing and in the overall name of the actual platform. You know what I mean? And, again, I don't fully blame Iwata, because people tend to forget that he's not a person that runs that damn company.
Mm-hmm.
It was the people that, you know, Iwata may have some, you know, may have some on him for that, but it's a lot of other people, too, that was under his tenure that said, yeah, let's go with that name, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I agree with you, like, it's weird that he didn't go, hold on a minute, we're going with this name? Really? Like, what you guys said, like, we're not going with Super Wii, we're going this, what?
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, I feel like, but if there's one thing that's nice, even after Iwata's untimely passing, is the fact that was the only, I feel like the only big failure that company has, because, yeah, the 3DS, when it started, was horrible. But that was because of pricing, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
At least people knew what the 3DS was. Oh, it's a DS, it's a stronger DS that has 3D compatibility.
Uh-huh.
Simple enough. But at least that was the only huge bomb in regards to sales and marketing that Nintendo has seen during his tenure. So having three consoles, but one being a complete failure, I see that's a successful run for a CEO.
Yes.
I just wanted to bring that up there, because I don't know if I was just sounding like too... I don't want to be too negative, especially the tone of what we were talking about in regards to Iwata passing. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Dane, what do you believe was Iwata's biggest failure as either was a developer in Nintendo or a president for the company?
I would say the approach to YouTube.
Oh, the content creators program?
Yeah.
I forgot that. You're right.
Yeah, with...
Hey, welcome back.
with like many of the games and many like and with the way that YouTube is, like, as soon as a big game comes out, people just like upload already to get into the algorithm and all that. But when they like
learn more about the,
this,
learn more about the fine print, basically.
Exactly.
Yeah. And like,
and it's sweet arena update.
Yeah. The fact of the matter is like, they had like some games that you know people can do YouTube videos of, but then they get like flagged for it.
Mm-hmm.
So like, you knew people upload like constant videos of Smash Brothers and.
Oh yeah.
All this and like that weren't even on the list and all that. Like.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
But see, that's the thing. It's funny because when you look at even at mainly at Iwata's failures. I don't feel like that, you know, like we just said, from our choices, that, you know, that was entirely Iwata's fault, because let's face fact, he isn't the only person that's been working there since the Famicom days / NES days.
Uh-huh.
There's been a lot of other shareholders still working there, and I think they've been the main problem, you know what I mean?
Mm.
Yeah, so I'm
like, I do feel like Iwata had influence, don't get me wrong, but, you know, I think the real culprit has been the shareholders, like with any freaking company.
Yeah, like I said, I'm not going to point the whole blame at him because, like, it must have been the rest of the company as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But, like, I don't know.
But I get what you're saying. They could have done something better in the ideal of what Iwata was striving with his philosophy. I get where you're coming from.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I hear you.
I don't know what I could put against him because I never really saw anything wrong with the guy.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I know it sounds like I'm kind of being a bit shallow, but
no.
I honestly didn't see much wrong with him.
But you didn't
know. I thought he was a down-to-earth, honest CEO of a big gaming company.
And that's rare, and that's a rare thing to see in this, and especially in this industry. And before Jerry came back in, like I said, I would rather have a successful CEO that had three successful consoles and at least one bond on under his portfolio than the very massive failures that we've seen from both Sony and Microsoft during their tenures of CEOs that knew dick about the industry that they were in.
Yeah, I hear you.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely. Anything else you want to add?
No, like I said, I can't really think of anything else he's done wrong.
Okay, now it's time for me, last but not least. And, there's only one failure I can think of off the top of my head, which it's not in relation to Wii, or Wii U, or the YouTube Content Creators Program.
Uh-huh.
In 2006, do you all remember a handheld by the name of the Game Boy Micro?
Oh, yes.
Oh, gosh, yes.
It was a compact, yet it was a more condensed, sophisticated version of the Game Boy Advance meant for the casual market, where it wasn't that big or bulky like the original Game Boy Advance or the Game Boy Advance SP were. And this came out in 2006, and the DS was already alive and doing very well for Nintendo at the time. And speaking of the DS, with the model and the DS Lite model, there was that functionality of backwards compatibility with Game Boy Advance titles.
Hmm.
I don't understand what Iwata was thinking in releasing the Game Boy Micro to the masses when you had the DS already, you know, doing well in terms of sales for the system. It's like, I felt that the Game Boy Micro was just completely obligatory at that time.
Mm.
I and it kind of makes me reflect back with how back in 2009 when there was that investors Q&A where Iwata admitted, along with Nintendo, that they felt their E3 presentation that year was not very good. When he made that quote that somebody, had to question about Iwata with their performance at E3, with him saying that he and Nintendo felt that their E3 presentation was not as good as they could have been, as the company did not, quote-unquote, bring about, did not convey the importance and the charm of the products that they showcased during that event, especially when it came to New Super Mario Bros. Wii at the time. And, you know, that definitely made me remember back to when the Game Boy Micro released, because I think Iwata said the exact same thing about the Game Boy Micro, that Nintendo didn't do a good job with conveying the importance and the charm of the product at the time. And, you know, it's like, it's kind of like, why did this product need some form of charm or importance when you had a successor that can pretty much have backwards compatibility with all Game Boy Advance titles?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, for me personally, I felt that there as his earliest tenure as president, that was probably like one of the biggest failures I could think of off the top of my head in past tense, but not in present times, you know, with Nintendo having the struggles with the Wii U. But you know, I've talked about my share with the Wii U and how I think it's a great console but not doing well sales wise but you know, when looking back at something that a lot of us, you know, might have completely overlooked, I just had to bring up the Game Boy Micro before, you know, right here for you all.
No, it's a good thing you brought it up.
Definitely.
In my life, I've only seen a few of them because not many people I know bought them, which is a partially sad thing because I would have bought them.
Yeah, it's like, who bought the last revision of the Wii that came out that didn't even have Wi-Fi capability? You know what I mean? That was
the
a
Wii
top.
Mini, yeah.
Yeah, the toter. It's like, what was the point? That was the Game Boy Micro all over again. But anyway, that's all I can think of. And with that all and out of the way, we have officially reached the end of this episode. So before we sign off and give a moment of silence, I am Double RPG.
I'm 16-bit Jeff.
I'm FighterXaos.
I'm Omega Maya 17.
Were there any plugs that you guys want to give before we log off this episode today?
For me and my end, for this particular episode, I'll save them until next time we talk. But if there's one thing you can do, you can follow me on Twitter on twitter.com/16bitjeff.
Mm-hmm.
FighterCounts.deviantart.com.
The same as me with like my YouTube channel would be in the description, which is Omega Maya 17.
All right.
On YouTube.
Okay, and you can find me on youtube.com/RRPG reviews, where I do reviews and 2 cents videos and whatever I can think of off the top of my head. And I also contribute to the gamers with the Riff Table Arcade as well as the Game Riffers Plays and that kind of stuff. Hopefully you'll actually see me do some more of that in the future, as well as reviews and that kind of stuff, which I honestly need to get back to. But hopefully sometime in the future I will actually plan a live stream where I do a stream to honor the late Satoru Iwata. So be on the lookout for more information coming from me as I post more details, whether if it's from Facebook. Yeah, it's mostly going to be on my Facebook, but probably also on my YouTube channel. But other than that, be on the lookout for more content coming from me and the future you won't even find anywhere else. So as we close this episode today, we will finally give a moment of silence and then we will end things off. So here's to our silence, and in the end, Satoru Iwata, you were a great president, visionary, and well-respected and humble man within the world during your times being alive on this very earth. We will honor you and remember you for all the accomplishments and the failures that you have given. But at the end of the day, we will always remember the many smiles you gave to all of our faces with your presence. Goodbye, and we will definitely see you again, once again in the future, in another time, in another life, Satoru Iwata. Godspeed, Mr. Iwata. Godspeed.